In this tutorial for Lab 18, we're going to cover ventilation. So ventilation is one of several processes associated with the respiratory system. Ventilation is comprised of inspiration, which is drawing air in, and expiration, which is pushing air out of the lungs. So ventilation, or the process of inspiration and expiration, is driven by changing the volume of the lungs. By changing the volume of the lungs, you change the pressure gradient, and air, just like fluid, flows down its pressure gradient from a high pressure to a low pressure. So if air is going to flow from the atmosphere into the lungs, you need to expand the rib cage and push down on the diaphragm so that you can expand the lungs and reduce the pressure. And you can see that briefly here in these two images. So in the left image, we have inspiration, more commonly known as inhalation. And so in order to drive inspiration, you expand the thoracic cage using the intercostal muscles wedged in between the rib bones and push down on the diaphragm, and that expands the lungs and draws air in. Conversely, expiration involves contracting that rib cage, letting the diaphragm come up, shrinks the volume of the lungs, creates a higher pressure inside the lungs, and that pushes air out. Now, much of the pre-lab deals with spirometry, and Lab 19 tutorial will cover this in much more detail. However, it is still part of this pre-lab, so we'll briefly cover it here. If you sit at rest and breathe normally, in, out, at rest, you are moving air. And that air that you move at rest with normal breathing is called tidal volume. The average amount of air that a person moves is roughly around half a liter or 0.5 liters. However, you could move a lot more air than that if you wanted to. So if you sit at rest and you breathe naturally in, out, and it does not feel forced, but then you try to force yourself to take a really deep breath, you would feel your rib cage expand, your diaphragm push down, and you would draw in a whole lot more air. So if I'm breathing at rest and then I want to draw in a lot more air, I go and try to really puff out my rib cage as much as possible. That additional volume of air that you could take in beyond what you normally move in ventilation is called the inspiratory reserve volume. And you can see that on the graph here, right there. So this is the normal tidal volume, and then what you can move beyond tidal volume into your lungs is your inspiratory reserve volume. The converse is also true. You can exhale out more than you typically do. And the extra amount that you can try to push out of your lungs by making your rib cage as small as possible is called your expiratory reserve volume. Now, in spirometry, one of the parameters that is measured is called the vital capacity. Vital capacity is the maximum amount of air that you could move in one breathing cycle. So to measure vital capacity, you would take in as much air as you possibly could and then blow out as much air as you possibly could. And you would measure how much air you actually exhaled. So to measure vital capacity, you enact a breathing pattern like this. Okay. In other words, you go all the way up here to the inspiratory, the top of your inspiratory reserve volume, and you push all the air out you can, and that collectively is your vital capacity. Now that we've covered a little bit of the pre-lab, let's get started on the lab activities. If we were to do this in a classroom setting, you would be broken up into groups, and each group would then rotate through 5 different stations. We're going to pretend that we're in our classroom setting, and we're going to go through those 5 stations. So the first station shows you a table of vital capacity based on age, biological sex, and height, all of which impact your vital capacity. So this chart here shows the vital capacity for males based on their height and based on their age. And you'll see the general trend as you go up in height, you have a greater vital capacity. As you go up in age, your vital capacity starts to decrease a little bit. So what drives those differences? Well, remember, vital capacity is the maximum amount of air that you can move in one breath. So basically, it's a measurement of how much air can you draw into your lungs and then push out of your lungs. So some of that's going to be dictated by your lungs and how much air space there is. The taller you are, the longer your lungs are going to be, and therefore the greater vital capacity. Males tend to have a greater vital capacity than females because of the way their rib cage is built. It's built more broad, where females, it slants in a little bit. And so their rib cage is a little smaller, so the lungs are a little bit smaller as well. And then the last one is age. So in lecture, you may have learned about two properties called compliance, which is the ability of the lungs to stretch, and elastance, which is the ability of the lungs to recoil. So both of those impact how much air you can move. And this should make basic sense to you. If I had a lung that was not very compliant, did not stretch, and not very elastant, did not recoil, no matter what I did, this is about all the change I could enact in that lung, and so I wouldn't be moving very much air at all. But if I had a really compliant lung, really stretched out and then really recoiled, I would be moving a lot more air in every breath. As we age, compliance and elastance both decrease a little bit. So you can see that here with the trend. As we age, our vital capacity goes down as a reflection of our loss of compliance and elastance. If you are a male, figure out your height in centimeters, and then determine what your predicted vital capacity would be. If you need to pause the video, go ahead. All right, if you are a female, you should write down your predicted vital capacity. Again, you'll need to determine your height in centimeters and then your age. So I am 166 centimeters and my age is, I would say, 42. I'm actually 41, but I'm closer to the 42 than the 40 mark. So if you look at my vital capacity, it says 2,920 milliliters. So remember, to convert that to liters, you simply divide that number by 1,000, or my predicted vital capacity is 2.92 liters. Okay, so that concludes station one. Let's take a look at station two. Station two looks at the gross anatomy and histology of the lungs. On these models, you should be able to find the trachea, the primary bronchi, and where the alveoli would be. In this image, you can also see the diaphragm and the intercostals as needed. Here, we have two histology slides showing the cross-sectional area of a normal lung and a lung of somebody who's afflicted with emphysema. So the first thing to do is take a look at the normal lung and look at the cell shape and size for the alveolar sacs, which are here. So these are the walls of the alveoli. And then immediately you'll notice something very different about the emphysema lung. It definitely looks different. But don't take my word for it based on a snapshot. Let's actually look at an entire scan of these slides. So here I have a bigger picture of a normal lung. And what I've done is I've actually taken a video of it. So we'll go ahead and watch this. All it's doing is the microscope is just moving the slide around so that you can get a look at the entire image on the slide. So that you can get a look at the entire specimen on the slide. So you can see over here we have some bronchi. There's the cartilage plates reinforcing those bronchi. But all of this here that I'm circling is going to be the alveoli. So those are all the alveolar sacs. All right, now let's take a look at the emphysema slide. Same thing, I'm going to show you a video. And once again, I'll point out where the alveoli are. So this is all alveolar tissue here. So these are all alveolar sacs. So right away, you should notice a very stark difference between the emphysema slide and the normal lung slide. Okay, so that concludes station two. Let's take a look at station three. Now, station three would have you take two pieces of saran wrap or cling wrap, put some water in between them, and wrap them around a lung, and then you pull on the outer layer and see what happens. This is meant to mimic the pleural membranes. So the pleural membranes are two serous membranes joined together by serous fluid. The serous fluid has a negative pressure to it, so it sticks those two serous membranes together. The outer serous membrane, which is also known as the parietal membrane, is stitched to the thoracic wall and the diaphragm, where the inner membrane, or the visceral membrane, is stitched to the alveolar sacs. So the concept is this. When you expand out your rib cage and pull down on your diaphragm, you pull the outer pleural membrane with it. Now, because serous fluid sticks that inner membrane to the outer membrane, when you pull the inner membrane goes with the outer membrane. And remember, what's attached to the inner membrane but the actual lung tissue? So this is how you get the lungs to expand when you expand out your thoracic cage. It is maintained by the fact that the two pleural membranes are stuck together. And we're going to mimic that here. So in this video, I have a sheet of sheer fabric that is meant to mimic lung tissue, and it is glued to saran wrap. So the saran wrap is the pleural membrane. So that layer of saran wrap is going to mimic the inner pleural membrane. Now we're going to throw some serous fluid on it, or water, and then I'm going to place another sheet of saran wrap on top of that to mimic the double serous membrane effect of the pleural membranes. Again, joined together or stuck together by that serous fluid. So now that they're attached by nothing more than water, I'm going to pick the outer layer and pick it up, and you'll see the inner layer, and therefore the lung tissue goes with it. And this part of the video just shows how difficult it is to pull those two layers of saran wrap apart with that water in between. All right, so that concludes station three. Let's go to station four. Now, station four involves Ziploc bags, and if you have one of these Ziploc bags, you can certainly try this at home. It's not particularly high tech. So station four is designed to show you that changing the volume of a container or a compartment changes the pressure. So this is what drives ventilation. By expanding the volume of the lungs, the pressure drops in the lungs and draws air in. By constricting or reducing the volume of the lungs, the pressure goes up and that pushes air out. So we're going to see this with a Ziploc bag.
Thank you.
watch that again, go ahead. And again, please do try this with your own Ziploc bag. It's not a high-tech experiment, but it aims to show you that by changing the volume of the bag, you change the pressure of air inside the bag and therefore create pressure gradients and can move air in or out of the bag based on those pressure gradients. So our last station looks at using a wet spirometer to measure vital capacity. In station one, we predicted our vital capacity based on age, biological sex, and height, but we don't actually know if it's accurate until we actually measure how much air can we move in a breath. And so to do this, we're going to call upon Dr. Rad. He is a male, about 6 feet, and I don't know his actual age, but we'll go with 39. I think that's a safe bet. And so if you go back, if you rewind the video and go back to station one, you can see what his predicted vital capacity is. And then let's take a look at his actual vital capacity.
The classic way of doing this, what we've got is this device where as I breathe out through here, air will collect in here, lifting this bin and allowing this marker to move. So we'll be taking a look at how that moves. All right, ready? Okay, so we're going to do a VC. I guess I need a... I didn't see how high it went.
Nice job, Dr. Rad. He actually displaced 5.5 liters. So his actual vital capacity is 5.5 liters. So I'm up next. Of course, I'm female. I'm 5'6", which is 166 centimeters. We already did my predicted vital capacity, which was 2.92 liters. And so let's see what I actually am able to displace. Not as much. So my actual vital capacity was 3.2 liters, a little bit more than my predicted, but not that much. All right, that concludes our Lab 18 tutorial. Once again, feel free to rewind and rewatch any part to help you with this lab. Thanks for watching.